In his recent trip to Europe, where he met with foreign leaders and also Pope John Paul II, the president constantly emphasized that the war against terrorism continues and is his top priority. In that context, FBI Director Robert Mueller and Attorney General John Ashcroft announced today major changes within the FBI. The changes are a direct response to criticism over intelligence failures before September 11th.
Events of September 11th marked a turning point for the FBI. And I say that because I think it's fair to say that after 9/11, it became clearer than ever that we had to fundamentally change the way we do our business. Now, as I recently testified, responding to the post-9/11 realities requires a redesigned and a refocused FBI. New technologies are required to support new and different operational practices, and we have to do a much better job at recruiting, managing, and training our workforce. We have to do a better job at collaborating with others, and as critically important, we have to do a better job managing, analyzing, and sharing information. In essence, we need a different approach that puts prevention above all else.
Where there are mistakes to acknowledge, we will not shy away from doing so. Those who step forward to voice their legitimate concerns will be welcomed, and often their ideas reviewed and embraced. We have worked and will continue to work with the September 11th Joint Inquiry of the House and Senate Intelligence Committees to examine the deficiencies in our intelligence gathering and analysis. We will strive to determine better how the enemies of freedom seek to exploit our system in order to murder innocent civilians. And we will never shy away from making the tough decisions to keep our citizens safe and our liberties secure.
One of the darkest clouds hanging over the issue of terrorism is the question of nuclear terrorism. Could it happen, and soon? Bill Keller is the columnist for the New York Times. He's also a senior writer for the New York Times Magazine. He writes about the threat of nuclear terrorism in an article entitled Nuclear Nightmares. It appears in the May 26 edition of the New York Times Magazine. I am pleased to have him on the program. Also, later in this program, we will talk to the actor Ben Affleck. There is a Hollywood question of nuclear terrorism. We will talk to Ben Affleck about that later in the show. But first, we begin with Bill Keller. I am pleased to have him here as we talk about this crucial and critical subject. Here's the cover of the magazine. It says the biggest reason for thinking that a nuclear terrorist attack won't happen is that it hasn't happened yet. And that is terrible logic. The problem is not that we are not doing enough. It is that there may be no such thing as enough. How scared should we be? By Bill Keller. Just give me a little bit of what led you to this assignment and what your assignment was.
The magazine editors and I talked a bit about this in February. We all kind of had in our heads and had had since September 11th that some future date terrorists might try to do something with what everybody now describes as weapons of mass destruction, and which for people of my generation tends to be nuclear. Mm-hmm. And I told them I'm not Cy Hirsch. I don't have a lifetime of intelligence sources, right. and I don't expect that I could, you know, root out some plan that has not yet been discovered, and I'm not an expert on this. We have people at the Times who are much more expert than I am in nuclear weaponry and physics. But what we settled on was the idea that a reasonably observant reporter would wallow in the subject for a while, talk to the experts here, talk to the experts in Russia, which is a place that you think about a lot in terms of nuclear terror because of what they have, and then try to do a sort of inventory of the possibilities and talk about how likely, to the extent that you can, not to put numbers on it, percentages, but a kind of impressionistic view of how afraid we should be, and specifically what of. That was the assignment, and that's right. What I tried to do. And I from the outset, I don't claim to be an expert. I've spent a lot of time
talking to people who are involved in this question. You know,
people in
the nuclear business as well as the business
as the non-proliferation business.
I read from this article, and of the many nightmares animated by the attacks, this is the one with pride of place in our experience in literature, and we know that from his own lips in Osama bin Laden's aspirations. In February, Tom Ridge, the Bush administration's Homeland Security chief, visited the New York Times for a conversation, and at the end, someone asked him, given all the things he had to worry about, hijacked airliners, anthrax, smallpox, germs, and crop dusters, what did he worry about? He cupped his hands prayerfully and pressed his fingertips to his lips. Nuclear, he said simply. My assignment here was to stare at that fear and inventory the possibilities. How afraid should we be, and what of exactly? I'll tell you outside, this was not one of those exercises in which weighing the fears and assigning them probabilities laid them to rest. You go on to say, the fact that New York was experiencing an earthquake, you know, was only my second thought when there was a sort of notion. The best reason for thinking it won't happen is that it hasn't happened yet, and that is terrible logic. The problem is not so much that we're not doing enough to prevent a terrorist from turning our atomic knowledge against us, although we are not. The problem is out there. There may be no such thing as enough. Why hasn't it happened yet?
Well, that's a good question. There are a lot of things I ask that about. I mean, why have we not experienced the kind of suicide bombings that Israel has experienced, for example? I think in the case of nuclear, some of it is luck. Maybe a lot of it is luck. Some of it is that that we have done some specific things to try to prevent it over the past 10 years. We've been doing a lot with the Russians to lock down their nuclear weapons and to make sure that they're better protected, and also to begin safeguarding the fissile material that a terrorist could use to make a bomb. And all of the things that operate kind of generically to thwart terror, of course, work for nuclear terror as well. How well they work is a kind of matter of lively debate at the moment, but they, you know, I think we've been to some extent protected by, inadequate as it has been, by our intelligence networks and so on.
There's a movie called Sum of All Fears in which the operative idea is that an Israeli nuclear bomb becomes available.
Mm-hmm.
How much, what's, is that scenario, not the Israeli portion, let's say the Russian portion, assess what you found out about that, the idea that somebody can get their hands on either a nuclear weapon or a tactical nuclear weapon, and explain the difference.
There are two categories of nuclear weapon, roughly. The strategic weapons, which are the big ones, the ones that, that Bush and Putin just signed another treaty to regulate. We have a whole, the whole history of arms control has been aimed at regulating those weapons, the ones that, that could go halfway around the globe and destroy a country. And then there are tactical weapons, which are generally smaller, intended for battlefield use. They might be artillery shells, they might be torpedoes, landmines, smaller weapons. Not mostly the kind of suitcase bombs that you read about. I think a lot of that is mythology, but small.
Right.
And the problem with the tactical weapons is that they've never been regulated by any arms control regime. There is a handshake deal between the first President Bush and the Russians, first Gorbachev, and then it was renewed with Yeltsin, that we would withdraw our tactical nuclear weapons and destroy them. But it included no verification, no accountability of any kind. And so the fact is, when it comes to tactical nuclear weapons, we don't know. The other big difference between the two of them is the strategic weapons, ours and theirs, although we know ours better, obviously, have what they call permissive action links, which prevent you from setting them off without having a certain number of certain very specific codes. Tactical nuclear weapons are less well protected.
Especially the older ones.
Especially the older generations, which in some cases apparently have no safeguards at all built in, so that you know, if you got one, you would stand a much better chance of setting it off. That said, the stolen weapons scenario is not the one that people worry about most. And I think that's because the scariest thing there is what we don't know. We don't know how many tactical nukes the Russians have. We don't know if they know how many they have. We don't know where they are. We don't know if they know where they are.
So one could have been stolen and not used.
One could have been stolen and not used, for all we know. There are so many for all we knows in the realm of particularly tactical nuclear weapons that that's you know, you've got to put a big asterisk beside anything you say about the stolen nuke scenario. But even so, the Russians do know how devastating it would be if they lost one. They know that the target might be them, not just us. We know that we assume that they have worked really hard to keep those secure.
And we have helped them in some ways.
And we have helped them to the extent that we can, right, given the mutual sensitivities about intrusive visits and so forth.
They fear that we're trying to spy on them, et cetera.
That's right. They tend to see these visits that are supposedly to help them build fences and install sensors at nuclear bunkers as intelligence gathering exercises.
You also argue that, or you make the point that, this notion of a suitcase bomb, mm-hmm, is unlikely to be the means of delivering a nuclear attack.
Well, I think the main thing about a suitcase bomb is that it doesn't matter. It isn't important. I mean, a suitcase bomb would have to be made by somebody very sophisticated. It would probably have to be one of these tactical nukes out of an arsenal somewhere rigged up. And yes, you conceivably could find one of those that's small enough. There's no evidence that such a weapon has existed. Alexander Lebed, the late Alexander Lebed, who was a general who may or may not have known, made some statements about some suitcase-sized tactical nuclear weapons going missing. Those seem less than fully credible. But the focusing on a suitcase kind of is a bit of a red herring, I think. Why would you need to make it that small? 2,000 containers, sort of 20 by 40 foot shipping containers, come into the U.S. every hour. 2% of them get opened. Most of them don't get x-rayed.
And nuclear are not easy to detect.
The
level of emission is not high.
That's right. The detection technology, while I think money is now going in very rapidly, being pumped into developing better detectors, the ones that exist are not great, and particularly uranium does not give off much of a signal for detectors. And uranium, highly enriched uranium, would be the material of choice probably for a terrorist bomb maker.
Why is that?
The alternative is plutonium. In order to make a plutonium bomb, you need much less with plutonium, but you have to essentially explosively squeeze it. You need to develop an implosion device that has to crush the plutonium evenly from all sides. It's very, very hard to do. Highly enriched uranium, all you need is two lumps of the stuff and essentially a big gun barrel. You shoot one lump into the other. I'm making this sound like I could do it, and I can't even program my VCR. But compared to the complexity of a plutonium bomb, highly enriched uranium is you take two pieces that are not critical mass, bang them together so that you have a critical mass, which is enough to sustain explosive fission, and bang.
Why do most of the experts believe that it is more likely someone with the intent of using a engaging in nuclear terrorism would build a bomb rather than steal a bomb?
Just because it's easier.
Just easier.
It's easier. Again, there's a caveat to everything you say on this subject. Some people worry about Pakistan, which has, by various estimates, 25 to 50 nuclear warheads, and has a program that was built kind of on stealth. You know, they built their weapons by acquiring fissile materials on the black market, by acquiring their expertise with sub rosa, and by basically lying to everybody about what they were doing until they'd done it. And there's a whole culture of subterfuge there. And some people worry that in a country like that, particularly given the affiliations between the government of Pakistan and the Taliban, it's possible that something they would be able to find a source in the Pakistani military who would either leak them the expertise or the material or even a warhead.
This is not the subject of this piece, but what do we know about how far along Osama bin Laden was in terms of his intent to find nuclear possibilities?
As far as I know, we only know that he had declared it as an intent. There have been a lot of stories about people who were supposedly agents for Osama bin Laden being caught in sting operations trying to acquire plutonium or highly enriched uranium and being sold something false. I couldn't find anybody who believes that there's credible evidence that sufficient material is out there. That doesn't mean it isn't, because as I say, the big thing that frightens you in all of this is what you don't know.
In fact, we do know that one of the nuclear scientists working for the Pakistanis did go into Afghanistan for one or more meetings.
Yeah, that's right. We know they had conversations.
And we don't know, was it with the Al-Qaeda or was it with the Taliban or some combination, or we don't know?
It was with some combination. The suspicion is that they talked about what you would need and where you would get it.
How do we go about this if we want to?
But we don't really know.
And this man denies it or not, do we know?
They don't deny that they had the conversation. They deny that they imparted anything very useful.
Okay. It's more likely that terrorists would build a bomb because it's easier.
That's. I'm sure you can find some experts who would disagree with that, but that seemed to be the consensus among the people I talked to, that it would be somewhat easier to start from scratch and build one than to steal one from the existing arsenals.
There is also this, which is part of the engagement here, the notion of radiation dispersal.
Mm-hmm.
How does that work, and why is that the most obvious thing that would happen?
Well, with a radiation weapon, or radiological weapon, or a dirty bomb,
and
as it's sometimes called, that's essentially a conventional explosive, dynamite, or one of those sort of Timothy McVeigh cocktails of fertilizer and fuel oil or whatever, combined with something that is a strong source of radiation. That could be uranium or plutonium. There are lots of readily available highly radioactive materials just in the civilian world. Cobalt, which is used in food processing to kill bacteria in food, and also used in some medical equipment. Cesium, which is used in medical instruments. Americium, which is used in smoke detectors, and some of these things are used in cement making, oil prospecting. There's a lot of that stuff around. And then there are smaller amounts of plutonium that aren't in any weapons program, they're just in laboratories.
Why hasn't that been used by now? I mean, at least that.
I don't know.
You don't know?
I wish I knew.
And when you'd ask these experts, what would they say?
I think they'd say we've been
lucky.
Same
thing you just said.
I think they'd say we've been lucky.
We and the Middle East and Afghanistan and wherever there's been conflict.
Right.
The world has been lucky. Well,
right.
Whether it's
up until September
Ireland
11th.
Or whether it's wherever there's been Yugoslavia, wherever there's been intense conflict, you would think that somebody would have tried it, wouldn't you?
Yeah, up until September 11th, there was a conventional wisdom that there was a sort of built-in self-defense to radiological weapons because handling the stuff was risky. And the chances are you would subject yourself to a lethal dose or at least assure that you were going to have cancer in a reasonably short period of time by messing with the stuff, and therefore people wouldn't mess with it.
That's gone out of the window with 9/11.
Right. One of the things that changed in our psychology is we know that people would be quite happy to.
Yeah. Speak to that in terms of nuclear terrorism. How does that change the equation? And maybe you just answered that, but in terms of radiation, how does that change the equation, the fact that people now, suicide bombers in the Middle East, suicide bombers in New York and Washington, are prepared to give their own life? They don't care. They care, but decide this is a way to get to heaven.
It makes it feel more real. That's the effect it has on me, and I think a lot of the people I've talked to. It just makes it feel more real.
What's the impact, having done this, you, former foreign editor of the New York Times, a guy who's had a lot of journalist experience, who reported from Russia and around the world, what did this do to you in terms of just a sense of the danger in reporting on this and talking to the people who know the subject and some who are responsible for stopping it?
Mm-hmm. I didn't feel any danger in the reporting of it.
No, I know, here's the question. I'm looking for some sense of whether you walked away from this reporting saying, this is much more dangerous than I ever imagined when I started this journey.
I did. I actually Although, you know, fear is
the reverse.
Fear is subjective, and I think it's selective, and you sort of decide for yourself what you're afraid of. There are some categories of nuclear terror that I find myself less afraid of now as a result of the reporting.
The stolen bomb idea or something
else? The stolen bomb idea is one. The one that you read about a lot is the idea of an attack on a nuclear power plant. And I don't mean to exaggerate the security of nuclear power plants, but I live not all that far from the Indian Point nuclear power plant, which is since September 11th particularly has been an object of great fear in Westchester County and the environs.
Could just set off all kinds of radiation is the idea, isn't it?
Right. The idea would be that a sort of September 11th scenario, somebody would try to crash an airplane into a nuclear power plant, setting off a great release of radiation and panic and sickness and death. And I don't mean to make light of other people's fears, but that's not something that keeps me awake after having reported this piece. Mainly because it seems to me a lot harder to do than I'd have thought before the reporting.
It reminds me of a conversation with the head of state who's of a country who's trying to get a bomb, or his critics say he is. He said in response to a question, does Osama bin Laden have nuclear bomb? And he said, I weapon of mass destruction. He said, I don't think so, because it's much harder than you think to build one. Mm-hmm. It is the notion, you found out that it was much more difficult to do this than you imagined. Yet at the home time, what's scary is we don't know. Mm-hmm. That's a fair summary, isn't it?
Yes.
What should the United States be doing?
This didn't start out as a policy piece, and it didn't really end up as one, and so I don't have a list of prescriptions. I mean, clearly, I think the right focus is on securing the fissile material, especially the weapons-grade, highly enriched uranium that could be used by a terrorist. We have a program, thanks to the foresight of a couple of U.S. senators, Sam Nunn and Dick Lugar, who 10 years ago passed this program where we basically pay the Russians to secure their fissile material. Mm. By the Department of Energy's, Department of Energy runs this program, and by their estimation, at the end of this year, we'll have about 41% of the Russians' weapons usable material secured. Now, that somewhat understates. There will be other material that's in the process of being secured, but that's not enormously reassuring. But clearly that program deserves to be a priority, and people in the administration agree with that. There's stuff you can do with detectors. Other stuff you can do with the stockpiles of fissile material is you can blend it down. You can pay, basically, to take the weapons-grade material, dilute it so that it's usable in nuclear reactors but isn't very good for a weapon, and then give it back to the countries, and we do a bit of that.
Let me quote from you this article, talking about a guy named Habegger, former chief of our nuclear arsenal. How do you, he just discussed the idea of somehow some bomb that's being built coming in on a container ship, if you remember the article. Mm-hmm. How do you protect against that, mused Habegger, am I saying it right? Mm-hmm. The former chief of our nuclear arsenal. You can't. That's scary. That's very, very scary. You set one of these off in Philadelphia, in New York City, San Francisco, Los Angeles, and you're going to kill tens of thousands of people, if not more. Habegger's view is it's not a matter of if, it's a matter of when, which may explain why he now lives in San Antonio.
I'm not sure that's why he lives in San Antonio, but I couldn't resist. He does live in San Antonio. He runs one of the local utilities.
I'm focusing on it's not
on
a matter of when,
right?
If it's a matter of when.
Yeah. Well, I'm not sure that I walk around. I don't walk around in a state of paralysis about this.
Clearly.
I don't expect it to. You know, the it's not a matter of when kind of lets you off the hook in terms of whether this could happen in the next year or in the next 20 years or the next 50 years, and I don't know the answer to that. I think it's quite likely that if there are terrorist networks around long enough, they will reach a point where they will try this.
More near-term than far-term, isn't it?
I think most people who deal in this area think that an attempt at a radiological weapon, one where you you don't get a mushroom cloud, but you get a lot of contamination, that would be in the near term. And everybody's a little more unspecific about when a terrorist group might be able to try an actual nuclear explosion. But I think it's probably something that's irresistible to them, and some of them have said so.
It's clear to me,
having read this and having talked to a lot of people, that it is clearly, it is what the administration worries the most about, the Bush administration, as Tom Rich said to you, said to the New York Times, and the Bush administration simply because of the way they created the axis of evil. That's all about weapons of mass destruction. And the fear is not that they're going to use them, although more fear about Iraq than anybody else. It is that somehow these are states that would give cover and deal with terrorists.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yes, I think that's right. And I don't think that's a crazy fear. I think you have to differentiate among these so-called axis of evil states, and it's a little simple-minded to treat them all as if they were one great entity. But to take Iraq, for example, I've wrestled with this question a bit, and in my mind, I can imagine quite clearly a scenario where Saddam Hussein would give a nuclear weapon to a terrorist who would use it. If he was reasonably confident that it wouldn't have a return address on it, yes, I think he would be willing to do that.
Yeah. It'd be a lot easier for a terrorist if they had somehow had the access to a nation state.
That's right.
Because of a whole bunch of things in terms of that they can make the process much easier. I leave this conversation with this. You decided to find out, whoever you contacted, I've forgotten his name, what would happen if a low-grade nuclear explosion took place at Times Square.
Mm-hmm. Right. It was the guy who helped me on this is a scientist at the Natural Resources Defense Council named Matthew McKinsey. I've talked to a number of people who do computer models of various scenarios, and he was the one who was helpful on this. We took, I was curious to know what kind of the bottom end of the spectrum of nuclear explosive threats. A 1 kiloton bomb would be a 15th of the force of the bomb that was detonated over Hiroshima. By the standards of any kind of national weapons program, it would be junk. And he did a calculation of what the blast and radiation effects and so on would be at various radiuses, and then I plugged them in with some population figures for who works in the Times Square area. I parked my bomb in front of the World Wrestling Federation on Times Square, no offense to wrestling fans, and some figures that the city keeps on tourist traffic, and we tried to do just kind of look at what it would mean. Obviously, it's hypothetical, but it was kind of way beyond the World Trade Center by several orders of magnitude, both in terms of the amount of death and the kind of durability of the metabolism of the event, if you will, because you get an explosion. Our estimate was that just the blast and radiation and heat from the explosion would kill something like 20,000 people in the first few seconds. And then you get people farther away who don't happen to be shielded by a building, who would get third-degree burns or radiation sickness and die before the end of the day. And then you get people a little farther away who, if they weren't protected, would maybe die in a week from radiation sickness. And then you have this sort of plume of poison, radioactive fallout that goes 2 miles up in the air, and about 40 minutes later it starts settling down to Earth, presumably about the time the rescue workers are arriving and the injured people are pouring out of the buildings. And then even that's not the end of it. The fallout travels on the prevailing winds out to the suburbs and kills more people. And then it's impossible to do a calculation of how long the cleanup would take or how long it would be before you could re-inhabit that part of New York.
The point of Bill Keller's piece and the point of this program we're doing is not to scare you. The point is to raise what is clearly by politicians and experts and concerned people around the world an issue that has to be understood and has to be addressed. My thanks to Bill Keller, who has written, I think, an extraordinary piece in the New York Times Magazine. Thank you.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. Stay with us.
Ben Affleck is here. At the age of 25, he and actor Matt Damon won the Oscar for Best Original Screenplay for their film Good Will Hunting. Since then, he has built an acting career starring in both smaller independent films and mainstream blockbusters. Here is a brief look at his career.
Grab a pole then, kid. Let's get going.
I don't think so, creep.
Mom?
Carl, get in the house.
Get in the house!
And you! Get the hell off my property.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, ma'am. I was just escorting your fine young son home from school.
I'm sorry there, man. She's a little new at this. Thanks. Thanks a lot.
Under, okay? Throw it under.
And this is where you take straight chicks on dates.
Oh, this place is like Spanish Fly. This will probably be the first time I don't score after.
I don't know what your reputation is in this town, but after the you tried to pull today, you can bet I'll be looking into you. Now, the business we have here too far, you can speak with my aforementioned attorney. Good day, gentlemen. And until that day comes, keep your ear to the grindstone.
Listen, that NASA computer is just playing it safe. The machine you built, the rig, can
shut
do it.
Shut up.
Back
up. Shut up. Shut your mouth.
Those men in that room have zero tolerance for showing off, hot-dogging, going by your gut instinct, or you trying to be a hero. You got that?
Say the words, AJ.
I got it.
The speech is excellent. Oh, then I see Queen Mab hath been with you. Excellent and a good length. But then he disappears for the length of a Bible.
There. You have this jewel. A skirmish of words and swords such as I never wrote, nor anyone. He dies with such passion and poetry as you ever heard. A plague on both your houses!
He dies?
You guys are the new blood. You're gonna go home with the Kesef. You are the future big swinging dicks of this firm. Now, y'all look money hungry, and that's good. Anybody tells you money's the root of all evil doesn't have any. They say money can't buy happiness. Look at the f-ing smile on my face. Ear to ear, baby.
I'm never going to be an English teacher. But I know why I'm here. To be a pilot. And you don't dogfight with manuals. You don't fly with gauges. I mean, it's all about feeling and speed and letting that plane become like a part of your body. And that manual says that the guy who's a slow reader can't be a good pilot. That file says I'm the best pilot in this room. Don't take my wings.
His latest film is a highly anticipated Tom Clancy thriller, The Sum of All Fears. I'm pleased to have Ben Affleck at this table for the first time. Welcome. It's great
thank
to have you.
Thank you so much. I'm a huge fan and admirer of the show. It's really a nice thing for me to be here, so thank you for having me.
We want to talk about a lot of things. Let's start with this film. How'd you end up being Jack Ryan?
It certainly surprised me. Basically, what happened was Harrison, for whatever reason, decided he didn't want to do it anymore. He had done two of them. And when he opted out of it, I think they started thinking to themselves, I think one of the difficulties they had with Harrison is that they didn't have a lot of places for him to go.
He'd already been president.
He had achieved so much and done all this stuff that it was hard. So I think they thought, if we kind of reinvent this and make him younger and take him back to kind of the year one phase, then we have a lot more room dramatically to kind of tell the story, a lot more opportunities, you know, that are ripe for cinematic exploitation, like the first time he's in the room with the director of the CIA, the first time he meets the president of the United States, that sort of thing, that first blush sort of stuff. And they with that conception of it in mind, they called me and sat down and I talked to Mace Neufeld, who's a producer, he kind of explained it to me as that, because at first I thought, no. This would be ludicrous. I'd just be sort of setting myself up to be assassinated trying to follow Harrison Ford and Alec Baldwin's fine actors. But ultimately, I realized that was kind of an interesting re-examination of it, starting over, and I figured that was something I could play, was a guy who didn't know when to keep his mouth shut, wasn't so sure of himself, didn't always say or wear the right things to work, you know, still sort of learning on the job. And it became like, in terms of my character's arc, a sort of coming of age story.
Did you think, as I think Clancy said to you, or according to what I read, Clancy said, this could be a retirement plan. Did you, for you, because it's a franchise.
It is a franchise. It's a successful franchise before I ever got on board. Mostly what I was worried about was just not screwing it up.
You first know time what
I
mean? Out,
was,
yeah.
You know, I just thought...
Don't worry about the next film.
Exactly.
The
and Clancy's a very blunt, you know, kind of straightforward guy. A very funny guy, actually. So that's his take on it. But for me, I was just taking it more one shot at a time.
Did know? Everybody say go for it? Harrison Ford and Alex Baldwin.
I talked
Tom
to
Clancy.
Alec. I talked to and Harrison, and just in part just because I so respected what they had done and so look up to and admire those guys that I sort of wanted to, I don't know what it was exactly, pay my respects. I guess hope to get their blessing, so that I could feel more confident about doing it if I had kind of talked to the previous guys a little bit. And then I talked to Clancy, and he was, you know, that was like a job interview. He didn't make any bones about it. Oh, you want to play Ryan, huh? What do you think about it? You know, and we went through the books, and we went through
come
the
old me, you can handle it, kid.
Yeah, exactly. And so I was down at his place in Maryland and with his wife, and we sat around the house and then went out to dinner and then came back and talked about it for a long time. And ultimately, you know, I don't know, I guess I said the right thing at some point in the course of the evening because, you know, he gave me a seal of approval. And he's a real asset to the...
He knows his military stuff.
Oh, he's extraordinary. And, you know, you read his books and you have a sense that they're authentic, that you're really getting a sense of, like, looking behind the curtain, seeing how things really work. Even at the CIA, they seemed almost rueful about kind of, well, yeah, Tom has some good sources here. You know, like, they didn't quite like the fact that he had such good sources inside the CIA, and I think he has equally good sources at the Pentagon, Defense Department.
And other people around the world, I suspect. Yeah. Did you have any reservations, or did the producers have any reservations about how to handle a subject like this, you know, a terrorist nuclear attack, at the time that it's in the front pages every day? In fact, over the weekend, the vice president made a speech at the Naval Academy saying this is a real possibility.
Yeah, they've been saying that that's a possibility. You know, they said that there was that we were inevitable that we'd be attacked again. Vice President Cheney said that, and Condoleezza Rice has echoed that. That seems to be a new tack the administration is taking in terms of, I'm not sure what, raising awareness of the public.
But the nuclear element makes it, in fact, the sum of all fears.
Right. It makes it really terrifying. And obviously, you know, when we went and shot the movie, we this was last, you know, a year ago, more than a year ago. So we had no idea that it would be such a hot button issue. It wasn't something that people talked about. I think Tom Clancy wrote the book as something of a cautionary tale in an effort to raise consciousness about not only the dangers of nuclear proliferation, but of the importance of safeguarding the arsenal of the former Soviet Union, be it the scientific, you know, intellectual property of the scientists as well as the warheads. And now, in terms of, you know, I'm just glad that I feel like we did it kind of in an intelligent, reasonable way that was faithful to the book and as a cautionary tale about what might happen, with the understanding that it's easier to respond to and prepare for something when you see it in a movie than it is when it happens in real life.
It's the lead story in the New York Times Magazine over the weekend, written by Bill Keller, former foreign editor of the New York Times, you know, the lead story. I mean, the timing here is amazing.
Yeah, and Bush and Putin, of course, signing a rather historic nuclear arms reduction pact last Friday. And not only that, but really another thing that the movie's about is about world leaders having the courage to sort of overcome, you know, mistrust and suspicion and a history of antagonism with one another to sort of, you know, be heroic and forge a new kind of leadership, which I think is applicable and necessary in the Middle East. So it's a little bit strange for me. I've never been involved in anything that was so current and so kind of ran so clearly parallel to what was happening in current events. And I'm sort of looking forward to what people's response is going to be. I'm not exactly sure.
Opens on Friday,
the 31st. Yeah.
What the interesting thing about it? You talked to Clancy about who is Jack Ryan.
Right.
He has some ideas about that.
Yes.
Which he's anxious to tell you.
Yeah. Yeah. He was very clear about what he wanted. He was very clear about who the character was and how he should be and how he should act. And you know, I listened to him. I mean, you know, with I have a lot of respect for writers, and Clancy, make sure you respect him and hear him out. And I did, you know, and I continued to email him and try to solicit his help because I felt like he could be a huge asset for, you know, just selfishly as filmmakers. You have this guy who is sort of the resident expert. You know, you use him. And he was smart, and I think he, you know, I'm very grateful to him.
You also got a chance to go down to the CIA and Virginia
and
talk
to Langley. That was fascinating. A guy named Chase took me through there. He was and I got to meet the director and the director of operations.
You met George Tennant?
I met George Tennant, yeah. While I was there, I just sort of like stopped in on him and a whole bunch of analysts. I spent a couple of days down there. They really like these books, and it's really important to them that people get it right, that their work be honored and be represented in a way that they feel is accurate. You know, probably nobody has suffered more mischaracterization in popular culture than the CIA. So they was something that they were concerned about. These people are extremely competent, very bright, and real patriots.
The interesting thing about the CIA, as you well know from that experience there, frequently they can't talk about their successes, and we hear about their failures.
Yeah.
You know, and the idea of the CIA is very much information gathering, and it is. I mean, it reminds us of 3 Days of the Condor. You remember the film with Robert Redford? Where it was all about reading novels. I mean, they go out and look at every possible information source.
Yeah.
And now with satellites and all the technology stuff.
And they collect disparate pieces of information, many of which seem unrelated. And this is another element of this movie, which is incredibly topical right now, which is to take. Collect several, seemingly unrelated pieces of information and sort of look at them as an incomplete jigsaw puzzle and try to, using intuition and educated guesswork, figure out how they relate to one another and what kind of a larger picture they might make and what that means and whether that's important to us and whether that should go in the daily brief to the president. And it's a lot of, they call the analysts intellectual heroes down there, and that's what it is, a lot of guessing, a lot of hypothesizing, a lot of time spent poring over the intelligence that comes in and trying to see how to make some sense of it.
Yeah. Take a look at this. This is a clip. This is where Ben, playing Jack Ryan, meets the CIA director, William Cabot, played by Morgan Freeman. Here it is.
Are you Ryan?
Yes, sir.
What is this, a paper chase?
What's your advice?
Well, come on, we're late. You're about to breathe air that's way over your pay grade, so listen up. You're going to be asked for analysis and advice, so be damn sure you know what you're talking about before you give it. Don't be afraid to say you don't know. And choose your words carefully. Words have a habit of being turned into policy. Hey, you. Give me your coat. Come on, you'll get it back.
Tie.
Okay.
Are you at all, I think I read somewhere, ambivalent about what you do? I mean, you've had a rather dramatic and meteoric rise, and you have chosen a variety of kinds of roles, including things like this, Armageddon being one, which are big money makers.
Mm-hmm.
Are you ambivalent about the acting part?
Yeah, I am ambivalent about it. I wonder about... I'm certainly ambivalent about the celebrity element. I think undue attention gets paid to it in a weird way, and I sometimes wonder, for me, in order to get the kinds of jobs that are more personally satisfying, to do movies about people and the little things they say and do to one another, nobody ever would give me those jobs, and I sort of figured out that if I did these movies that made a bunch of money. Then I'd get a chance to get the better scripts. Now, fortunately, with this movie, I happen to have done one this is really for grown-ups. This is a much smarter version of that. They don't always turn out as well as this movie did. I feel ambivalent about it. I feel ambivalent about the whole thing. I feel ambivalent about the way people, the importance placed on actors, I feel ambivalent about what it does to me as a person.
Fame, celebrity,
what you have to do to support movies, what that does to you, what it does to your life. The danger is in some ways that your life and your world becomes like one of those old West kind of facade towns where you walk by and it looks like the old saloon and the general store, and then you peek around to the side, you see it's just a front.
Exactly.
That's the danger. I think that kind of thing happens to you, which is why I like to do more writing and maybe direct and also just some living, I think, which helps flesh out all the rest of that stuff.
Can you take a break? Can you do that?
I would like to. That desire, of course, is at odds with this. It's sort of counterintuitive to what you've developed in a life of struggling
exactly right,
and trying
exactly
to get ahead
all
and get
of a
sudden
job. The opportunity is to work and you want to work.
There, and you've been unemployed and you've struggled for so long, and here the sun is shining, and so you want to make as much hay as you can, and I think everybody knows that actors' careers, being dependent on the fickle public taste is, you get a time span, you get a period of time where, you know, people are willing to give you a shot, and I certainly want to work as hard as I can, do the best work that I can, so that I can be proud of the body of work that I put together. And so those two instincts are somewhat at odds. You know?
If in deciding how you handle all this, who do you go to? I mean, where does the advice come from?
Well, that's the thing.
There's nobody who's living it, so therefore they're active.
Yeah, there are people who are living it. I've talked to a lot of older, for example, there are lots of little things. I talked to Morgan about reviews, for example. In fact, as I was doing this movie, I said, Morgan, do you read reviews?
This was around Pearl Harbor time.
Around Pearl Harbor time, yeah. I looked at
Pearl Harbor Post, had a hit.
It tore, terrible. I thought, I started feeling that movie. I felt like, Robert De Niro in Raging Bull. You know, you didn't knock me down, Ray. I learned to develop a thicker skin there. And actually, you know, I didn't disagree with some of the things that were said about the movie, but I asked Morgan, how do you treat reviews? And Morgan, flat out doesn't read any of them, just refuses to. Still seemed to be burning over a comment somebody made about some of his work in 1974.
And don't we all?
Morgan, you're one of the great living actors. What do you care? You know, but yeah. And that was sort of his point, that it you care too much and it affects what you do. So there are people, obviously, that I try to seek out for counsel, whom I respect. But I think, like most things, ultimately in life, you sort of have to figure this stuff out. What kind of life you want to have for yourself? What kind of man do I want to be? What kind of life do I want to have? And answer those questions kind of in the dark of my own conscience and sense of myself,
What film has brought you the most, apart from this one, just simply to get you off the hook there, has brought you the most satisfaction in terms of the kind of thing, that sort of touched all of your bases?
Well, probably the movie I did before this, Changing Lanes.
Which did well.
Which did very well, particularly for a sort of morality play, which is what it is. Allowed me to do some things as an actor that I hadn't had the chance to do. And a movie that I did, which hasn't come out yet, which is called Geely, is what I think I got to do my best work as an actor and stretch the most and explore the most stuff. And
Martin it's a Brest, comedy?
It's a drama comedy.
You're a hitman, is this?
I'm a sort of a pathetic wannabe hitman guy. But it's actually about this weird, I kidnap a brain-damaged kid and this woman, then the guy who hired me doesn't really trust me, so he hires this woman to be my supervisor, and it's about the strange family dynamics that emerge during the course of this kidnapping. And it's mostly a movie unlike any other, so that was the one that gave me the most sort of, I think, creative, artistic stimulation, besides some of our fears, of course.
What amazes me about you is that because, perhaps it's because of the way you look and all of that, I mean, there's a whole list of people who say terrific things about you in term one after the other. When Gwyneth talks about liking you and has something to say about role of Matt Damon, Frankenheimer talks about reminding him of a young Warren Beatty in terms of choosing roles and all those kinds of things. If you look at what you want to do, 10 years from now, you'll be acting or directing or?
Probably less acting, I hope. Probably more writing and directing, I hope so, if I have the opportunity to do it.
Because it's always seemed to me that people like Beatty, who did all of it, Redford, Eastwood, in a sense, seize control of their careers by doing those things.
And also, I think what happens is that you start to develop, you do enough movies, and at first, it all seems beyond you and like this great magical process that happens. And then slowly the process sort of gets demystified as you do it enough. And then you start to have a real sense of not only where you want your character to go, but an instinct about where you think the story should go, how it should be told. And that's where you're starting to reach beyond your stars, so to speak, in terms of, you're essentially a marionette. You're a role player. You're doing one thing. It's not really appropriate for an actor to try to or to want to dictate those other things. But if you develop those instincts kind of as a storyteller and you start to think, this is the way the whole story should be told, then there's only one way to do that, which is to try to do it yourself,
You also have this instinct for business, for the business of producing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's interesting. It's another way, because producing in some ways is the ultimate way, even before you come on as a director, for some projects like the Project Greenlight, for example, or this television show we have coming on in the fall, Push Nevada, which I was a contributing writer to and an executive producer of. you get to do the same thing, which is to sort of shape the way it's presented, the way it's created, the way it's marketed to the public. And also, it's the only way to try to convince people who are investors, who want to be your financial partners in these projects, that you to take risks, because you say, okay, look, we're going to try to break some new ground here. This is something people haven't done before, and here are the ways I think you can make money. And because that's ultimately the only pitch that, that people really, with fiduciary responsibilities to shareholders and so on, are receptive to, and appropriately so.
Tell the story of some of all fears is in fact, there is a Russian, an Israeli bomb.
What happens is that there's a bomb in the Yom Kippur War that was lost and is dug up and by some Arabs who just happen to be sort of out there trading, and they figure someone can buy it, because as they say, there's always someone will always buy junk like that, and there's always a market for weapons, unfortunately. And so they
especially nuclear,
right? So they go try to sell it on the market, and it falls into the hands of some people who are kind of like a neo-21st century sort of fascist movement, who feel as though that they would benefit by the superpowers being at war with one another, because a world without superpowers benefits regionalized power.
In fact, they say there's a line in which the guy says, look, rather, we can't take on Russia and the United States. What we'll do is have the United States and Russia take on each other. And that,
exactly.
In fact, becomes the core of the conflict.
The heart of the movie. And at the same time, you have this young analyst named Jack Ryan who's starting at the CIA and just started dating this woman and hasn't told her where he works. And
that's great.
He's sort of a nobody at the agency. He has written a paper, which is mostly what analysts do, saying, you know, there's this sort of fringe character who may take power in Russia. When that, in fact, exact thing does happen, he's sort of vaunted up to a place where all of a sudden people are listening to him a little bit. He meets the director, played by Morgan, in the scene we saw, and his career takes off. Meanwhile, this terrorist plot is taking shape, and throughout the course of this movie, as Ryan gets involved in it, nuclear disarmament diplomatic mission with Cabot, he starts to uncover some pieces of this possible plot and tries to prevent this terrorist act from happening.
Remembering, based on what you just said, the Russian president is called Nemirov, played by Kieran Hines.
Kieran Hines, yes.
And here it is. Take a look at this.
A pleasure, sir. May I present Dr. Ryan,
Mr. President?
Ви тот самый доктор Райан, который меня так хорошо изучил.
You must be the Dr. Ryan who has done such interesting research on me.
Не удивляйтесь. Вы написали, что в институте я был бабником.
For instance, we know how wrong you were in your report that I had many girlfriends in college.
На самом деле, после того, как я встретил свою жену на третьем курсе, я ни разу не посмотрел на другую женщину.
I met my wife in my third year and have not looked at another woman since.
I was referring to the first 2 years. Когда вы сдали на личный экзамен по английскому, I like you. But in that case, so do I.
It's great to have you here. I hope you'll come back. There's
Please.
Lots of things we can talk about.
I would love to. It's been a pleasure.
Thank
really.
You.
Charlie Rose is made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, a conversation with Bob Carey, the president of the New School, about growing up in Nebraska, Vietnam, receiving the Congressional Medal of Honor, and more.